Hi guys, welcome back to the Friend Zone podcast.
Hi guys.
My name is Tandy and I am Benedict's.
Hi guys, I'm Tandy's husband.
Hi, okay.
Maybe we should apologize people
for being so inconsistent.
Yeah.
Guys, you know, we really want to be consistent. It's just that life has been lifing. I'll be honest about that.
Yeah.
We have had to deal with so much. I think when we started the podcast, we didn't actually know what we're going to be getting into.
I didn't understand it.
Because the first podcast we had started was The Desert in the Podcast, which will be coming back because there's a lot of stuff we've been dealing with spiritually which needs to be talked about. So most of these podcasts going forward, at least for the next few couple of episodes, will have like a spiritual connotation which we need to explain. So yeah, if you're not subscribed to the Voice Letters of Podcast, please make sure you go ahead and subscribe to it. We'll put a link in the show notes.
Should we give them a little, you know,
yeah, teaser? Guys,
it about?
Yeah, like, so basically we just went through a season. Like, basically, so after we got engaged, which is basically what these podcast episodes going forward are going to be about. After we got engaged, we started finding out that there was witchcraft going on, especially on my side of the family. A very close relative, had like bad plans and wanted to kill people. And apparently I was meant to not have children, not to get married, yada, yada, yada. And then...
That's enough.
Oh, this is the big part though.
Which part?
The part that's where she like had initiated me into witchcraft unknowingly.
Yeah.
So obviously, we've been dealing with a lot. Mentally, we've been trying to fight and leave that place. You know, I don't know if you guys know what an exorcism is. Anyway, let's get into TMI.
Yeah.
For this podcast, for TMI, yeah. Guys. But to be honest, we're just trying to explain the gravity of what we've been dealing with.
Yeah. So anyway.
Yeah, guys. Woo! Okay. So, maybe do you want to introduce this one?
So this is a Lobola series, and we're going to be talking about...
It's Lobola. Don't get English. It's not Lobola. It's Lobola.
That's what?
Lobola. Say it, baby. Come on.
Lobola.
Say it like you mean. It's Lobola.
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 I'm a Lobolo.
I'm a Lobolo.
Ugh. Yeah.
You can't see an old dog in your tricks.
Oh, what? Oh, yeah. So you admit that men are dogs. Okay, thank you.
Yes.
Okay.
And I'm an old one, too.
Men, here's your spokesperson. You just said the other dogs.
A 28-year-old dog.
Hey. Oh, my gosh. Babe, yeah. So, basically, guys, we're going to be doing a
Lobola series. And, yeah,
very serious.
We're just going to be talking about all the things that are entailed, you know, in this Rora stuff.
Yeah. You know? My husband is Sean and I'm Debele. So, yeah, because these guys are coming to our house, who basically went to the, just say this low as Lobola because I'm a Lobola Atandi. And I'm a Lobola Atandi and Fadi and Tandy. That day was so beautiful. So, guys, we're basically going to make a couple of episodes in this Lobola series to share with you for when it will be useful. We have a couple of friends who are engaged and will be dealing with this pre-haha very soon. So we thought to make this episode, these episodes, to make this series.
As a heads up.
As a heads up to them and to anyone else who might be in a similar situation pretty soon.
So, first things first. This is Mjolo Premium. Like, you've gone Mjolo Pro Max 1 TB version, you know? It's no longer just about you and your person, you know? You are now getting serious with things and you're now involving the greater family. So
and that's where everything goes bust.
So that's the first thing. The first thing you need to know is to pick a team, you know. Who's on your team? Because the day you decide, bro, I have a ring with me and I think I'm going to propose. you can't go and say that without the drinks with the boys, you mm-hmm. know. Unless you chat like that with your boys, but there's very few people who should have this period information.
Mm-hmm.
I think for me, the first person I told was my little sister.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Oh, like months before even. That's yeah, what you later told me.
Yeah.
So like by then you knew you wanted to marry me.
Yeah, that was like last year. So,
so you knew you wanted to marry me last year?
I knew.
Oh my gosh. Why didn't you tell me?
would never hear the end of it. I know you wouldn't believe it anyway.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
So wait, can I ask you just a minute if we can just digress? By Christmas, did you know you wanted to marry me? Ah!
I knew.
Oh my gosh. So it took you less than 3 months. Wait, it took you 2 months.
Fairly.
What?
Yeah.
Oh my gosh, so cute. Yeah.
So, yeah, I told my little sister, you know, and then I think I told my little brother.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. But the person who knew what I was up to all along was my little sister.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, then you also need to pick relatives who need to know this sort of stuff.
Mm-hmm. So not every relative needs to know.
Yeah, I remember when we were working on the ring,
mm-hmm.
the only person I shared this information with was with Gogo.
Mm.
And I said, Gogo, I'm trusting this information to you with my life. So,
hey, and gun to her head, she never said anything.
She never said like, anything to you.
Said, no, if I tell you, Fadi will never trust me. I'm like, why does it even matter? Like, I wouldn't tell them that you told me. She refused.
Yeah, so you want to be very selective about who knows this sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Because you don't know what people can do.
And you don't know who's watching.
And you don't know who's actually for the idea.
I mean, from the experience we'd had, you know, when people realized we were together, you know.
Yeah.
There were quite a lot of adverse reactions.
Mm.
So, you know, in the spirit of guarding your peace and, you know, just keeping things
between within, you guys.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You want to be very selective about who gets to know this sort of information.
Mm-hmm.
Then, obviously, you need to understand how things work in different cultures.
Mm-hmm.
You need to understand what is the context of you two,
mm-hmm.
you know. What is the role of parents,
mm-hmm.
extended family, if mm-hmm. they need to be there? Who needs
who
to be
gets involved first, yeah.
You know. Pane pane kinzi, ah, no, nya, it's no man, so na tete, but you know, kuti, the tete is it, house, hey.
Yeah, I can't involve them.
You know, for one reason or another. You know,
maybe they're
too far. Maybe they're just too far.
They don't believe in
stuff. Or maybe you're just not that tight. You know, it's just weird to then try to warm up to someone you have not been close with your whole life.
Yeah.
Not for any bad blood or anything.
Mm-hmm.
But then suddenly,
you're just not there. And that's the thing. I feel like slowly things have changed. I don't know if it's for every family, but for our family particularly, for both our families.
Mm-hmm.
Back in the day, no matter what happened, your tete had to be involved first, or your uncle's wife.
Yeah.
But then I think for us, particularly for us, like things were actually really different. So we got to individually handpick who we wanted to involve. And I remember for us, it was just like a joke. Literally, we're taking a walk one Sunday afternoon.
Mm-hmm.
And then one Sunday late afternoon. And my grandma was just like, just putting us a lot of grief. Basically, she just started saying, hey, you never come home early. Why don't you ever cook at home? It got so bad. So much that Fadi and I just got to the end of it. Like, you know what? Let's get married. No, we actually wanted to get married. But it was more of, you know, what we had intended on doing later. Let's just do it now.
Mm-hmm.
So, literally the next morning, I just thought we were having a conversation, just joking about it. Because it was, what, I think 5 months into our relationship. And so I wasn't really certain, okay, like, are we just talking, you know, futuristically?
So you were not sure about me, huh?
No, I was sure. Listen, I was sure about you. I just wasn't sure, like, do you mean, like, how soon do you mean let's do it now? You know, I didn't know if it was more of, okay, let's do it soon, like, maybe 5 months, in 5 months or in 6 months, you know.
So
essentially when we then said, and then the next day, literally, you're like, yeah, so talk to your uncles. I'm like, what? You meant this type of suit? Like, oh my gosh, okay. So literally just took my phone out and called my uncle. And yeah, told him, and he said he'd be able to come down to Zim. So yeah, when he said he was waiting to be able to come to Zim, and then like he asked for the date, and we're like, the dates, because normally what happens is your fiance's the guy side or the guy's aunt approaches the girl's family, and then they get a date from the girl's family. But for us, it was very different. For us, my uncle just asked us for a date. Like, he's like, okay, so what date do you guys want to work with? And we're like, okay. And then we picked a date. I think we picked the 12th of April. We picked a date, and my uncle's like, cool, I'll book my tickets and come down. We're like, just like that, you know? Yeah. So first, it was very non-traditional, which I do appreciate a lot of people will have to deal with. So normally what happens is you take your tetes, and then they go, they write a letter. No, you just like spoke, like you'd been talking on the phone.
Beforehand, yeah?
Yeah. So basically you need...
That's another thing.
Yeah, you can't just like tell you... I think that's why my family was so open, because everyone knew you. Everyone had a relationship with you, independent of your relationship with me.
I think that's the other thing as well, that people don't, you know, talk about.
Mm-hmm.
But introducing someone to your family,
mm-hmm,
is a very important thing,
mm-hmm,
you know. I remember when I told my sister, the one I gave it to you, she was so ecstatic about the idea. She fell in love with you, you know. Same thing with all my siblings, mm-hmm, basically. So it then, you know, eases people's minds,
mm-hmm,
when they know who they're dealing with.
Yeah.
It's different when you just show up and say,
this is the guy.
We're going to marry this girl.
Yeah, because then they don't even know this person. I think for me, that was one of the main things I had in mind. I remember when you said, like, when... we mentioned to the family that, to the greater family that wanted to get married, I remember people saying, okay, so we need to go and do the formal introductions. I'm like, I haven't even met my future in-laws. Mm-hmm. I've met everyone else, but not mom and dad.
Mm-hmm.
I felt that, you know, you had a chance to build a rapport, my family, build relationships. Like, my uncle trusted you to the point that, like, everyone was just good. Like, I know, we know our little girl's in good hands, you know. And that's what essentially matters. My whole family had so much confidence and faith in you that they had, because they had studied you, they had like watched you, they had built a relationship with you. So they knew the kind of person you were. It definitely made it way easier. So I felt like me just going to meet mom and dad when we started the official introductions, hey man, that would be, guys, unfair competition. Like, sorry, why are we leaving me in this spot? Why do I have to be the one who just starts with everything when it's already formalized? You know, so we actually planned a trip to Gweru, and I have a YouTube video,
yeah,
on that. Yeah, I have a YouTube video, like, in my Indo Uzbek and stuff like that. So it definitely made things easier, because the day we went for official introductions, man, that was so chilled vibes. Like, I was doing what I wanted to do. I was so relaxed. The nerves were not there because I knew the family. And, you know, even I was laughing with my aunts. I was like, oh, do you guys want a home tour, a short home tour, a short house? Yeah. Mom was even laughing because she was like, God, this one knows this house already. And it was so good. It was so lovely. It was so enjoyable because we had like a backstory. So I really feel if you can have the opportunity to meet both sides of family,
informally,
it goes a long way.
Yeah.
So even when people start writing their list, they know who they're dealing with also. They're not like saying, we don't know you, our list just writes anything we want to write. They don't care much,
mm-hmm,
you know? And there's no friendship. It's just out. Like, this is just the sign and door, guys.
Yeah.
Mkwasha, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So... yeah, I really feel before introductions begin formally,
you need to
know each other. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think I had left off with the whole like picking a date thing, like how we picked our own date.
Yeah, mm-hmm. I think everyone has a unique set of circumstances, you know. We're primarily banking on your uncle being here,
mm-hmm.
you know, to do this whole thing.
Mm-hmm.
So, in our case, it was a little different. And your uncle was not in Zim,
mm-hmm.
you know, which would have been way different if he was local.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, like, him saying, I can only travel between this date and this date, put a lot of pressure on us to pick a date.
Yeah.
Like, and we didn't have the time of, oh, okay, can we pick a date and get back to you? Because we called him, mm-hmm. and he wanted a date on the spot. So, we just looked at each other and just randomly picked a date.
Yeah.
A midweek date, because, yeah.
Well,
we wanted privacy.
We'll explain that another day.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right.
So, yeah. It's quite an interesting thing, informing family. Well, in my case, it got me on a lot of road trips, you know.
Mm.
And I don't know if I actually thought about that beforehand. Which, okay, this will mean a trip to Sky, this will mean a trip to Gweru, mm-hmm. and a bunch more for intros and when you start doing the stuff. And yeah, it came with its own fair share of adventure, you know?
It did. It really did.
It did. So,
I think the first trip we made was to Bulawayo to go and form. Actually, when we went there, Yeah, we went there to inform my granddad's sister, because she's the only one remaining. Mm-hmm. So we went there to inform her about our plans,
mm-hmm.
and so that she could meet you, because she wasn't going to be there on the actual day. Mm-hmm. So yeah, the welcome was so warm. It was so warm. It was beautiful. And everyone just fell in love with you. So I think for me, that was real confirmation.
No choice, man.
Well, they had a choice.
It's me, bro.
Yeah, but like I'm saying, it would have really complicated things. You know, for me, to be honest, obviously, if you listen to this, you've passed that stage. But if you haven't reached that stage, I'll be honest. Like, I honestly feel like when you date a person, you're dating the family as well. Like, you need to get to know. Because, you know, your partner can have, especially if your siblings were raised in the same house. You have certain characteristics or certain traits that are constant across the board. You know, like across the body of children.
Yeah.
Yeah. Across the body of children. You have certain things that are constant and consistent. So if you guys were raised by the same people and you were taught to share, all of you will have the ethic to share.
Mm-hmm.
So it's very easy for you to decipher if a person is acting by looking at how things are with their siblings, how the siblings conduct themselves, you know. You can actually easily tell, like, okay, these people. So for me, I think it gave me, like, are you okay?
I'm good. I'm listening.
You seem bored.
No, I'm listening to what you're saying.
Oh my gosh. So for people who are raised in the same house, you obviously see a lot of, okay, they are similar. And I think it helped me to ease up when I realized that you all had good hearts. So it wasn't you making like an act and like acting like you had a good heart. Meanwhile, you had like a bad heart, you know, like where I got shot. So
are there people like that?
You don't know. They're there. So, I think it's really important for you to kind of study the family you're getting into. Because you also might realize that you like the guy, but this family, you're not the right fit. You're not the right candidate to fit into that family.
Mm-hmm.
Be it maybe the way they do things, their philosophies and stuff like that. You might find, I think for you, you quickly got to see something across all my uncles. Like, okay, this is just something that's there. Like, they're all nice, understand? It definitely helped you to also decipher what kind of family you were getting into.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the sample size was bigger. It wasn't just me and Gogo anymore. So I really feel it's important for you to know the family you're getting into. Like, you must know what you're getting yourself into. Because if anything goes wrong, these are the people who are going to sit you down and, like, try and help you iron out your issues. So, yeah, that's something you definitely need to know before, well, as you plan the Rora and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And it's also very, very important to understand who is important, you know, you will meet a lot of faces,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Mm-hmm.
And as usual, whenever you meet people, a lot of things will be said.
Mm.
A lot of statements will be passed.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you let some things get to you, you know, it won't really...
Yeah, I think you should be more, like, divulge some more, because what you're saying right now, most of us probably won't get.
So you'll meet a first-generation uncle. Mm-hmm. Then you meet a sixth-generation uncle there,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Mm-hmm.
Probably has his own views and stuff, and, mm-hmm. you know. Basically, in the real mix of things, if anything was to go wrong,
mm-hmm.
he's not the immediate person,
mm-hmm.
you see. So... That again, you know, makes you realize, okay, if I hear this man saying stuff, right?
Does it matter or does it not matter?
You know, because isn't it just like, yeah, it's relative, but it's just there, you know?
Mm.
It's just there. It's different when it's from your mom,
mm-hmm.
you know, or mm-hmm. from your direct uncle,
mm.
you know? That definitely has some gravity.
Mm.
So... That's the other thing as well.
Because when you, like, get into the circle of the greater family, not everyone is going to feel the same about you.
And you'll find very nasty characters.
Exactly. So you need to be aware of the fact that, yes, you might want people to like you, but not everyone will like you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, you'll just meet some people in
and
the greater
you'll
family.
And you'll meet some very
like
terrible
you.
Characters, you know.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The bigger the pan, the more likely you're going to come across some very rough ones.
Yeah. So,
yeah, but the whole experience of meeting family was definitely fun, you know, mm-hmm. because
people are excited and all of that.
And then you get to actually fuse your sense of families, mm-hmm. you know, and that's a thing that people need to realize when you're dating, you know, this,
it's
this
not
thing
just
called
about you.
Sense of family.
Mm.
Sense of family does not mean to say you have identical upbringing. Right? Mm. You and I had very different upbringings, mm. you know?
It's the philosophies of family.
It's the philosophy of family and, mm. you know...
The view of family.
And strangely, as most people wouldn't expect, you and I actually have
the
exact same sense of family,
yeah.
mm. you know? Despite our different upbringings
mm.
you know? So that's a thing to look at, you know? What's your worldview? What's your sense of family? Because if you are all about sharing, if you believe in sharing, for example,
mm-hmm.
and your prospective partner doesn't look at it as sharing, they think of it as other people taking advantage of you,
mm-hmm.
you know?
Mm-hmm.
And then causes problems because the reality of being married is you are now involving families. And when families get involved, there's a lot of... You know, sharing that happens.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful information.
Mm-hmm.
Some sensitive things that you probably kept to yourself for mm-hmm. your life.
I think that's the other thing. The certain things you probably wouldn't have to divulge or would, like, talk about. If, the certain things you would need to talk about as a dating couple, which then must be talked about as an engaged couple. And I must warn you about this. There's certain information about you that you might have held close to your heart, which will just be asked, you know. And for me, I think it was about my dad. I never really talked about my dad because he's not in the picture for me like that. So when my in-laws innocently started asking about that side and that thing, about that topic, about my dad, and yada, 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 it got very uncomfortable. And most times it comes from a good place. People don't know that they're actually stepping on, like, a wound or they're, like, it's not in a spiteful way of, oh, we want to hurt you. Or we want you're undeserving. It's just they're asking so that they understand
Turn
what they gain to you, and they're trying to understand.
Mm-hmm.
So you will find that a lot of information you consider sensitive has to be talked about. Like, it must be talked about. So if you have a child, there's no way like, people will not talk about, does she have a child? Yes, she has a child. Where is the father of the child? And then it's talked about, you know? Like, how did you get pregnant? And then the father of the child is not involved, you know? Like, these are things that will be asked. They're sensitive information, but it will be asked.
Yeah, those things will be asked.
They'll be asked.
And I think also for me was, you know, you are a masuhu.
Mm-hmm.
My sister is married to a masuku as well.
Guys, that was the most complicated bit. Because there was this incest thing that, this incest check that then had to be run. Like, yeah, so, are you sure?
Part of it was convincing my sister that, no, you guys are not
related. We just have related. The same surname.
Just a surname, you know?
And not just your sister, it was for the greater family. Really? Because even when we went to mom and dad, and they're like, hey, Masu, because they were checking with your sister, like, are you sure
these people are not related?
Are not related, you know? Because they would mean, like, and in which case for us, because she's married to a Masuku, like, that still meant directly we're not related. So even I think that could have been fixed culturally.
Yeah.
Through izinkomo or something. Something could just have been done to fix that. But it's something you need to ascertain before.
I think actually some people actually assume that you are related to Mandla.
Oh, yeah.
I remember when we went home with a pasta.
Yeah, they're like, also, are they Mandla's sister?
No. They actually just say Jinae and Jads. I'm like, no, bro, these people are not related, man. They're not related. It's just similar surnames, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
It's just like how many times I've met Vananonza Nakunaka, you know? Mm-hmm. And I think I've never, you know, met those people.
And I think for me it was weird because, like, my little brother's called Mandla.
Yeah.
So I remember the first time you told me, like, on Insta, we were still, like, talking. The first time we're talking, like, my in-law, Mandla Masuka, I'm like, are you trying to, like... Are you throwing hints? Are you trying to ask me out? What are you trying to do? And then I realized later, like, no, it's true.
I do. So you thought I was being funny?
Yeah. Golly, so it was really odd, guys. Like, we've got like two people with the same name, guys.
Yeah.
So strange. But anyway,
so yeah. That's the nature of these things. They open wounds. There's certain things you wouldn't want people to discuss, but people need to know.
Yeah, and they must be discussed.
They must be discussed.
And disclaimer, if you have a child, I know at times you might say, oh, this is sensitive information. But I was just saying to myself, like, if my dad's story was sensitive, what about for a person who's got a child? Because now it's not something that just doesn't matter. Because it doesn't matter to your man, but I'll tell you this. It will matter to the whole family. So it will matter to the whole family because now people can be thinking, so won't this man just come and claim his child and won't this man come back into your life, yada, yada. So these are things to discuss with your partner, but also to let it be known to your in-laws when things are starting to get serious that you have a child. Like, let them meet this little kid when you meet them as well. Don't just go there alone all the time. They'll be like, anemana, we didn't even know.
And I think it applies to both sides as
yes, well. Yes, definitely.
I think the downside for the woman is...
It's something people would obviously
see because the kid's probably staying, you know. But with guys, you know, I mean, we do a lot of things as guys. And
that's the thing, like, if your girlfriend doesn't know that you've got a child, I think for me that was actually like a deal breaker. Like, I knew I didn't want to be with the person who had a child. You're looking at me like that. Oh my god, I knew I did not want to be a stepmom. I don't have anything against being like a stepmom, but I knew that is not something I want. I wanted to experience the first kick, the first crawl, the first fall, everything. When my man also said, oh wow, this actually happens, I want both of us to be confused, not like one of us to like know what's going on. Like, relax,
bro.
Braxton Hicks, that nothing serious. I didn't want that, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So it's something you will need to talk, because even if your boyfriend doesn't tell you, like, his family will tell you, you know, he's got a child, right? things get messy when the family gets involved, bro.
But well, that's the reality of it.
It is.
It's no longer just about you. It's about the family.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how grave this thing is. And you can't just run away now. Like, bye-bye.
And that's the thing, like, even after this, soon after you do the Lobola payment, guys, like, exchange rather. Like, I tell you, you know, I think hours, soon after, hours, just a few hours after the Lobola exchange had been done and they had said, okay, you're now in-laws. I was just eating my plate of food from lunchtime. My aunts, they were all breathing down my necks. Has your husband eaten? Hey, how can you eat before your husband eats? Hey, how can you be eating when your husband's not eating? I'm like, guys, what a stage. I'm just trying to eat my food. So I quickly learned that, like, you can't eat without your husband also eating. You need to eat at the same time. Like, if you're eating, he must be eating or he has eaten. Like, you cannot eat and he has not eaten. Like, it is illegal. illegal. Like, yeah, but, okay, I think we should, like, make another podcast episode now, guys, because this one's getting too long. So we'll just record it now and then just continue the conversation, and hopefully you can catch on to it in the next episode.
All right, guys. See you in the next one.